Hello and welcome to this week's Seventh Circuit Journey. I'm Rickley Stone. When the Flamingo Cafe opened its doors a little over a year ago, the idea was to offer Tallahasseeans something special. 5 months ago, it did just that, and the laughter hasn't stopped since. 10 years ago, Alpha's Hubert L. Chasen retired from teaching, but not from learning. In fact, Hubert is one of nature's star pupils. The color of the holiday season comes alive with poinsettias, and the poinsettias come alive through the loving care of Leon County's Charlotte Umholtz. Sometimes things happen in life that change us forever. Ron Wagner knows that for a fact. He learned the hard way in Vietnam. But the owner of Tallahassee's Pearl Oyster Bar has proved that life is what you make it, and Ron is making the most of his, as we'll see when we meet him this week on Southern Circuit. Stay with us. With all the ills of our times, now more than ever, comedy is sweeping the nation as a preferred form of entertainment. And so it is in Tallahassee. The evidence can be found each weekend at the Flamingo Cafe, where a packed house seems to prove the old adage that laughter really is the best medicine.
Good evening. Welcome to the Flamingo Cafe. How's everybody doing? Oh, lively, lively group. Huh? Sure. Everybody wants to be a comedian on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, right?
Our concept of cafe is like a melting pot for all walks of life to come to. In planning this, because of the area, the size we have, we knew that we couldn't go with, you know, large groups as far as live entertainment goes, but we wanted to have some type of entertainment. And it was in our thought that later on down the road, seeing how business went and what have you, that we would try and do live comedy. Because being next door, you've got the Fine Arts Building, there's a lot of really good talent over there. So it was, I guess about 4 months ago, we decided, well, we'll give it a try when the semester started back. And we started out on Thursday nights as open floor night. So anybody who wants to come in and try out, you know, can. Then on the acts that we see that we feel that would go over, you know, with the people, it doesn't matter what I think of a group or, you know, if it's two comedians or one comedian or what have you. If the audience likes them, then we'll go ahead and book them for the weekends. And just starting it out, we have three fellas that work with us real good from next door, and they're more or less the fellas, you know, the troupe that's here all the time. And then we had one female lady that came in and tried out and just took the audience by storm. And so we've got a troupe now of about five comedians that are booked every Friday and Saturday night.
How are you all doing tonight? You all doing good? Good. Now ask me how I'm doing. I'm not doing so good. I'm really not. Well, hell, I don't know. But me and my girlfriend just broke up. And, well, I don't know. She moved in with another guy, and I draw the line right there. Forget it. I mean, so basically, I've dumped her, okay? So.
Chris started with us in the very beginning. Chris
I don't know.
Is.
Plays
real good
myself,
to a crowd.
Okay?
Chris
I do.
Is. The type of person that people sometimes like to heckle him, okay? And where he's strong, so
anyway.
He can come back just like that and put him, I want to say, put him in their place, okay? But can get a point across, draw a laugh, and stop the heckling.
I tell you, I don't get no respect at all, right? I tell you. I go to a hotel. I said, hey, bellboy, you want to handle my bag? He says, sure. He starts feeling up my wife, you know? I said, hey, who told you could do that? He said, everybody, you know?
It's gotten to the point where it's standing room only. And it's the response that we've had from the community has been just tremendous on it. I mean, it's something that people said, you know, Tallahassee has needed this for a long time. And, you know, you get tired of crying. You know, you want to hear some, you know, you want to laugh. And that's basically what it's all about.
Let's have a nice round of applause, please, for Mr. J. Woodmansey.
Yes.
Move the mic down a little bit.
How y'all doing this evening?
Well, this is this half of the room. Let's come on, you can win.
How are we doing this evening?
Okay, I think you should pay this crowd, Jim. It sounds okay.
Jake started out maybe 3-4 weeks after we first started doing the comedy. Jay's routine is basically into old TV shows, commercials, that type of thing. Does a real good job for us. Jay's more or less the front runner. He usually starts out the comedy. Okay. Then Margaret, who's our first female comedian, came in on a Thursday night to try out. Was nervous, which is understandable, you know, your first time coming into a place. So we booked her for that weekend, and Margaret was the first comedian to draw a standing ovation. And Saturday night, she tore the house down.
Do you men realize how many ugly women there are out there? I mean, come on. I know that it's a scary thing to wake up in the morning without your face on, okay? How do you think my hair stands up? How many of you men have woken up next to the faceless wonder? You know? You've got your eyelashes up to here, and you got your lips down to there, and you're going, oh, what did I bring home? Thank God for Helena Rubinstein, you know what I'm saying, girls?
So next time the fat lady gets on the bus and wants and says, excuse me, is that Satankin? Just do Jack Nicholson. Turn to her and go, hell no, I've been waiting just for you. Why don't you sit right down here, we'll have a little talk. Maybe I chew your eyebrow off for something. You know,
Rob is probably the strongest comedian that we have right now. Okay, one being that since he started out with us in the beginning, he's built up a routine per se that he can carry an audience probably a good hour. Okay, with no breaks.
Here we are, the capital, the fastest growing state in the nation, and we got the dinkiest airport. I'm serious. Got one gate. And it's gate 6. Well, I want to know, what happened to the other 5 gates? They don't have enough room here, so they put them in Tampa? Yeah. Well, you've been a great audience. Thank you very much. It was a little long tonight. Sorry about that. Be good.
It's a natural high. That's what it's all about, is having a nice time, having a good time, being able to laugh. When I see people laughing, when I see people having a good time, when I see people talking about it, then I know the things that we're trying to do are working. And it's all geared for the people.
Once in a while, you meet someone who seems to have a little tighter grip on the way things are supposed to work. Maybe they have more horse sense than the rest of us. Hubert Chasen is like that. He's a retired teacher, a perpetual student of nature, and he has a passion for ancient artifacts, which he pulls out of the Chapola River by the thousands.
Your real big highs in life come from achievement and from appreciation of beauty and things of that sort. You can't get it out of the bottle. You can get one, but it won't last. The lasting high comes from doing something and that you love to do, and if you can do it a little better than that other fella, you have a ball. That's the way it goes. And so with this thing, it was a fun thing. I just love that old river.
It's probably a turtle hole. Yep, that's what it is.
I got started a little late in this, and earlier divers had picked up the larger things. You see, swift rivers have a way of sorting objects made of stone and depositing them in piles according to size. Would you believe that? There's 180 that I can enter into 100 yards below, and I'll find very fine sand. 50 feet upriver, I may find that sand much larger. And then another 50 yards up, I may find a deposit of coarse sand, then fine pebbles, and on up till you hit fist-sized pebbles. And this is the reason the early diver got most of the large artifacts. The river has an ongoing process of processing the sand and forming deposits that range all the way from fine silt two heavy fist-sized pebbles. Well, your stone pipes will be in with those larger pebbles. Some diver has emptied his trash right here in the landing. But it's not altogether trash. This point here looks like a throwaway, but it has been first a spear point and was used as such, and then converted to a scraper. This edge, it could have been hafted or held in the hand. This edge was used as a scraper. I've got so many treasures. They become treasures to me. The best ones become treasures. I'm worth more than money. A man offered me $1,000 for one of these cheap points. I mean, one of these treasures. His money's no good. Even though I'm not rich folks. I'm poor folks, always been poor folks. But values, I place values where I want them to be. And that's the right of an individual. And these things are big with me. When I find an outstanding point, it's a high point in my life because I found this thing and I figured that it had been saved for me through hundreds and thousands of years, especially for me, see. And the napper did a good job of preparing a rare point, a very rare point. But the river added some beauty there in putting a mineral deposit on there that has colors that can be out of this world in a patina on a well-made spear point or arrowhead.
What's the story behind that one?
The story behind it is that I was searching for points, and I'd had very poor luck that day. But all of a sudden, I saw this out of this world color up in a crevice, water about knee-deep. And I reached in and caught it by the nose and pulled it out. And the patina was out of this world. Colors fire me up anyway. The color on a fresh and molted coral snake. The colors are so brilliant that you can't believe them.
But this
thing in broad daylight was glowing, just glowing in sunshine. Glowing with a color I'll never see again, I've never seen before, but it just fired me up. I was an old man dancing around there, and my little boy, who was 12, was downriver a piece searching, and he thought that old Pappy had got on a cottonmouth, and he came hurrying up as fast as he could to see what was the matter with Pappy. Well, I turned and held that point out to that 12-year-old boy, and he started dancing and screaming. Outdoors, I've lived outdoors, and I love the outdoors, and especially love this beautiful river. And it drew me in there to fish, to swim, and when I finally got time after I got to be old folks to start searching that river for these things, I knew they were in there. I'd seen them while I was fishing. It got to be an obsession. And man alive, I have more fun in one hunt than you'll have in 5 years. One hunt, because it got that big with me, especially if I found a good one. It reached a point. Well, I won't continue. It's just you wouldn't believe what I'm telling you.
So little of the delight and brilliance seems to linger when the holiday season is suddenly over. But Yuletide visitors to this pleasant hilltop near Terrace, Florida, can take home the one thing that has for centuries combined the joy of Christmas with the year-round joy of growing things.
The poinsettia is said to have originated in a miracle. Mexican legend tells of a poor peasant boy who yearned for something very special to give the newborn Christ child. But nothing grand could he afford. So before the village altar, he knelt humbly to pray. So sincere were his pleas that when he arose, there sprang from the barren earth at his feet the one gift no one else could give. And thus was born the flower of the holy night, whose flaming bracts have adorned the winter season ever since. They brighten and prolong our holiday season in part because folks like Charlotte Umholtz love to grow things.
They're still pretty all into February, you know. You really have to know what you're doing if you're going to grow poinsettias, because they have to be grown in a controlled environment to begin with. If you don't control the environment, you won't get them to bloom. And they bloom in the short days. You can't get put a flashlight on them like this without keeping them from blooming to a certain extent the next year. So some people will have their plants and they'll never bloom, and they'll wonder why, and it's because they get lights on them. They either get a porch light or a street light or something like that on the plant. Come on here now. I had mine by Thanksgiving time, even though I didn't black cloth them, because I treat them with Psychocell too, which is a growth retardant that keeps them from getting too tall. I have some leggy ones down there now that actually they didn't have enough space to grow, and that's why they have to have a certain amount of space. See, there's so many things about poinsettias that you really have to be careful about. They have to be in a very pure environment. In other words, before I take a cutting of the poinsettia, I sterilize my hands, I sterilize the knife, I sterilize the pan that I put the cuttings in. I don't set the pan on the table. The table is sterilized before you put the pot on the table. So it really has to be a sort of a sterile environment. That's to keep down disease, and then you don't keep it all down. Most people that grow poinsettias will start them from cuttings. They start them from a tip cutting about 4 to 6 inches long. And I plant them one in the center of a 6-inch pot and put them under a misting bed. And it takes about 10 days to 2 weeks for them to root. They'll first callus over on the bottom. And then you start giving them some fertilizer, continuous liquid feed, and then they will root. And when they have 4 or 5 nodes, then you pinch the top out of them, and that leaves a shoot to come out on each one of the nodes. And if you look at one of these plants, this one, for instance, see, that one was left with 3 nodes because there's 3 blooms on that plant. I grow bedding plants, all different kinds of bedding plants. Like right now I have pansies and calendulas and petunias, and they're not nearly as hard to grow as poinsettias. most anybody can grow those kinds of bedding plants and vegetable plants, you know. I grow a lot of vegetable plants. I lived in Tampa area most of my life, since I was 5 years old. That's a good long time. I was widowed in 69 and was alone for 7 years, and I married a man that lives in Tallahassee, and I commuted back and forth for 2 years, and then I came up here and stayed. I came up here and I really wanted to learn, just, you know, to grow plants for a hobby. But I didn't think I knew enough, so I went to school. And if, you know, I went to Lively Botech. They have an excellent program there. And I always say if I can do anything, it's because of the good program that they have at Lively Botech, because I wouldn't know how to grow poinsettias if I had not been to school there. I really got interested in growing herbs, and I grow all different kinds of herbs. Matter of fact, Tallahassee nurseries asked me if I'd grow herbs for them, and I did, and then I got into everything. There's a lot of therapy and walking into a room with plants that you've been working with, and maybe you've had some problems with them and you brought them out of it, you know. I get a lot out of the pretty flowers. I love them. And I get a lot out of people that come to see them, because for instance, I had a lady that came over the other day and she said, "Oh, I felt so bad at home, but I just knew if I came over here I'd feel good again because the flowers are so pretty." So, you know, you feel like you're really doing something that makes people happy, and flowers make people happy.
In 1967, Ron Wagner stepped on a mine in Vietnam and found himself knocking on heaven's door. He lost an eye, both legs, and the use of his right arm, but never his will to live, in spite of the odds against his recovery. Today, Ron has built a life for himself that not only portrays a survivor, but an inspiration.
Well, March 3rd of 1967, I was wounded for a third time on third day of third month. Makes you sort of wonder if three is an unlucky number for me. But I stepped on a landmine and I lost both my legs and my left eye, and pretty well the use of my right hand and various other scarring and other odds and ends. And I was in poor shape for a while, you know, but I said I had great support. And as long as you got support from people you care about, and there's no problem. So I ended up having a great time in the hospital. You know, I mean, I was laying there miserable, but I had fun. Yeah. Yeah, life's what you make it. See, I think of having an artificial leg as being almost hereditary. My granddaddy had one, my uncle had one, so I was quite used to it, you know. I'd seen it before. The guys I seen hurt in Vietnam messed up like I was. I used to look at them and say, if that ever happens to me, I'd rather be dead. But your will to live is fantastic. When it happens, I never thought about dying. Thought about living, you know. And it's no different if you cut off your hand on the way back to the office. I mean, your life's not going to change that much. You're limited somewhat in what you can do, but you still love life just as much. I probably appreciate it more because, you know, I've been close to it. They told me I wasn't gonna live before. They told me I'd never walk before. And I do everything pretty well, I think, you know. Like I said, it probably makes me appreciate it more.
All right, you comfortable?
Yes, sir.
I'm gonna have to make you out down now. I can't get up with you up there.
Okay, do it. Try. Try. Whoa, Daddy! He said no.
Don't step on my flowers.
My mom always said everything happens for the best, and I really believe her. If I hadn't been hurt, I'd probably never met my wife. Wouldn't have the life I have now, you know. I'd probably been some old mean ass, pardon the expression, you know. Out fighting and drinking all the time or something. But, you know, there's something good comes out of everything. And hey, I can't say what my life would have been like if I hadn't been hurt. I know it would have been different. You know, I had to adapt considerably and find out what I could do and what I couldn't do, but, well, you do.
And Juan's done just fine. Over the last 16 years, he's tried his hand at a number of different occupations, from painting houses to teaching school. 2 months ago, Ron opened The Pearl, a seafood and oyster bar that he hopes will fulfill his dreams and those of the community.
We were going nowhere, you know, barely paying our bills, and no matter what we did, we couldn't get ahead, so thought it was time to try something different. And we looked around and thought, well, we'll try an oyster bar. We love to eat oysters. There's no place we can go and carry the kids, and there was none on this side of town, so we thought we'd try that. Never had any experience in it, but it seemed like the only thing that we might be able to pull off, and So we tried it. And, you know, it's turned out to be interesting so far.
It was on the sink. It was about to go. Luckily, two of them were empty at the time.
Hey, give me my $7 back. $7.
We're more family oriented. Yeah, while there's beer and wine and everything else and video games, it's a place where most of my friends come in and bring their kids in with them. And most of them have commented it's nice. They've never had any place they can go to with the kids. And they can sit there with the kids, and the kids will play pool with mom and daddy. And, you know, they eat some oysters, and the kids will try oysters. Some of them like them, some of them don't. You know, it's, they enjoy it. You know, it's very seldom mom and daddy do something like that. Generally, they get off work. They've got Friday and Saturday night, and they want to go out. So this way, they can sort of compromise and do it all. And the kids can be with them. I'm happy, you know. There's always something more you can have or want, but there always will be. If I was making $1 million, it would be something else I wanted. So, you know, I've got everything. Everything I need, basically. I love my kids, and I love my wife and my family, and we have a good time. That's what counts. So, you know, it's not really that simple, but basically that's it. So I'm content. You know, I accept my condition. I'm in pain a lot, but I know that always will be. Have been for 15 years, so I'm sort of used to it by now. Don't bother me. I mean, it bothers me sometimes, but, you know, it don't really bother me. Well, I've seen people that hurt far less that had far more problems. I think it's more the way you are before you hurt, really, than it's not after you hurt. If you're not that way before you hurt, you're not going to be that way afterwards. I always loved doing things before, and I love doing things now. And I spend a lot of time in the wheelchair, especially around my house here. Like I said, I have to really watch my time, but I've gotten good at it, and I'm going to do everything I can. And I realize that the older I get, the more problems I'm going to have. It's going to become extremely difficult. I've noticed it in the last 3 or 4 years. I've slowed down considerably. So I want to try and do everything I can now. You know, when I am confined to a wheelchair at the bed, then at least I'll have good memories. I won't be happy anyway. You just go with what you got. What can I say?
That's Seventh Circuit for this week. Thank you for being with us. Next week, Seventh Circuit features four individuals who, through their writing or their photography or both, have contributed to this area's history. We'll meet them and look forward to seeing you then. Good night.